Hey friends, you know, there's a saying that friends don't let friends right-click deploy. Now, I do occasionally right-click deploy, but Azure's got multiple services that help you deploy your application automatically and safely, and Barry's going to show me how today on Azure Friday. Hey friends, I'm Scott Hanselman, and it's Azure Friday. I'm here with Azure Barry. Always loving how you break down information, and deployment is another one. There's multiple ways to deploy stuff on Azure, and sometimes I just right-click and deploy, which can be a great option. It's just not a sustainable option if you have to deploy on the regular, isn't it?
Yeah, that's what it is. You can do that, but it's just not sustainable. And on the long run, it will cost more trouble and cost more time and money than if you actually set up a system for it.
Okay, so I've heard that we can do Git deploys, and we can use GitHub Actions, and we can use Azure DevOps, and we can use third-party services. We can do zip deploys. There's a lot of ways to deploy things on Azure.
Yeah, but I'll just I'll keep it very simple.
Okay,
you know, there are just a couple of services that you could or should use, and ways that you should use to deploy your application to Azure. And in this episode, I'm just gonna try and help you decide which ones that you should use for which scenario.
All right, let's do it.
So before we dive into the services that you can use to deploy your application to Azure, let me just share some context of what we're actually talking about, and that is continuous integration and continuous delivery. So within continuous integration, you have developers and also operations people. Hopefully they're working together in some sort of a DevOps way. They're all making stuff. So developers make code for applications, and hopefully operations people also make infrastructure as code or ARM templates, things like that. And they then check that into source control, which could be GitHub, for instance, or Azure repo. And when they do that, hopefully also on a regular basis, then the build pipeline that would then activate. And that thing, what that does, is it would take the code from the source control, it would then build it, so compile the code, maybe also run some tests on it, some unit tests or some other tests. And if that all goes well, then it would take the package, so the resulting package, which could then be an application, but also some infrastructure artifacts like ARM templates, so an updated infrastructure, let's say. It takes that, it then gives that to the release pipeline, and the release pipeline then creates or updates infrastructure with, let's say, the ARM templates. It will then deploy your application to the new and updated infrastructure. It will then run tests as well, maybe more unit tests or other tests, maybe functional tests as well. And this would also then be the place where a test people would then do a manual test and potentially also sign off on the release, do a release approval if you configure it that way. And then from there, it would then be released to production, which means your application is actually in production. And then from there, users can start to use your new version of your application. And then they would tell what they think to product management. You know, maybe they report some bugs, or maybe they have some ideas about the application. Maybe they want some new features. Product management collects all that information, creates requirements and stories for the teams of developers and operations. And so the cycle continues on with continuous integration and continuous delivery. Now, the build pipeline in continuous delivery is an automated thing. This thing runs whenever you check in code into source control. And then when you call it continuous delivery, the release pipeline is actually something that you do on demand. So you would have your completed build of your application and also your infrastructure artifacts, and you would then press a button to release all of that to production. And then the nuance here is when you call it continuous deployment, which is slightly different, then again, the build pipeline is automated, but then also the release pipeline is automated, which means as soon as you check something into source control, it basically gets deployed all the way to production. So that's a little bit of context for what CI and CD actually means. Now, within Azure, you have multiple options to deploy stuff to Azure. So why would you actually do all of that, set up a CI and CD process? You would do that to get higher quality applications. So when you do that, the process is actually automated, which means that you don't deploy manually anymore, reading steps from a script, and therefore you have less errors and higher quality software. Also, you can deliver faster because now you don't have so many manual steps and not that many people involved, which means you can just deploy faster and also automate it. Costs are also lower because there are less people involved and the quality is higher, so you don't need to solve as many bugs. And finally, you have more flexibility, which means that you can change your application quicker to adhere to whatever the users actually want. So you could create features and deploy those within a week instead of having complete deployment weekends, which can take a long time. Now, within Azure, you have lots of options to actually deploy your code to Azure. Now, like Scott alluded to, you could use in Visual Studio or even Visual Studio Code, you could right-click publish, which is a way to do it, which gets your code actually into Azure. So you can do that, but it's not repeatable because that means that the profile of actually doing that, the information of how your computer deploys that thing to Azure, is only on your local computer. And then when somebody else does that, it is slightly different. And you want that to always be the same, because when it's slightly different and then the application does something different or an error occurs or something, you don't exactly know why that is. So it's not that repeatable, and it's also not automated there. And it doesn't really work well when you work with multiple people. So then what do you do? What are your alternatives? Well, you could use Azure DevOps as an alternative. Azure DevOps is an application lifecycle management suite. There's multiple services that you can use to store your code in and also to create build pipelines and release pipelines. You could also use Visual Studio App Center, which kind of does the same, but then for mobile applications. Then there's also Azure DevOps Starter, which is an Azure portal experience that helps you to set up pipelines within Azure DevOps. And then finally, there's also GitHub Actions, which is kind of a lightweight application lifecycle management suite, but then located within GitHub itself. So you could use GitHub Action to deploy your code from the code that is stored in GitHub. So how do you choose between these services? What should you use? Well, I then ask this question, and that's a very simple question. What type of app do you want to deploy? And then once you've answered that, you can take a look at the functionality of these different services to see if they fit your needs. Now, let's take a look at that question. What type of application do you want to deploy? Is that a mobile application? Then that's kind of simple, because then you would use Visual Studio App Center, which is specialized in testing, deploying mobile applications. If it is anything else, then you can use all of these other services as well, Azure DevOps, Azure DevOps Starter, and also GitHub Actions. So let's first look at the Azure DevOps Starter to give you some context of what that actually is. Here in the Azure portal, I can start to create a resource, and then I can say DevOps Starter, and then it would pop up the wizard. Like I said, that is an Azure portal helper experience that helps you to set up pipelines within Azure DevOps. So it doesn't actually provide you with a pipeline right here in Azure, but it sets something up in Azure DevOps. And this is a very easy way to get started. So first of all, it will ask you what type of application do you have? And this can be anything really, .NET, Node.js, Python, Go, Ruby, C, what have you. From there, I selected .NET. Now I can select what type of .NET application do you want to deploy? Is that ASP.NET, ASP.NET Core, maybe some IoT thing, and maybe you also have a database there. And then it will ask me, where do you want to deploy this to? Is that to an app service web app, to an Azure function, a virtual machine, or maybe something else as well? Let's just say web app for this sake. And then I can create a web app here or select one here to deploy it to. And once I do, it then creates a release and a build pipeline within Azure DevOps that I can use. And that looks like this. This here is the Azure DevOps portal. This is one of my projects that I use. And we're here looking at one of the build pipelines. So all of these steps that you see here actually compile my code and make it into a package that I can then use to deploy to my Azure websites, to my Azure App Services web app in my case, which is very cool. This gets triggered automatically when I check in my source code. So whenever I do that, this whole process starts to run, and then afterwards, my release pipeline starts to run. And that is this one. Let's take a look at what the steps are in this one. So this consists out of actually getting the package, receiving the package, which is the application in this case, and then following these steps here, which in my case is deploying some of it to an Azure function, and then also deploying the application to an app server slot, and then later on swapping that slot with the actual production slot. So this is very flexible, because I can create lots of steps here, and those are all predefined steps that you can just use out of the box, like deploying to an app service, for instance, also to a database, and lots of other things, like to containers as well, which means that you just drag and drop these things into your pipeline, and then you just configure those to make them work for you, which is very cool. Now, that's a bit of the functionality of the Azure DevOps Starter and also Azure DevOps. Now, let's put these next to each other and help you choose between all of the services. So we've had Azure DevOps, App Center, Visual Studio App Center, Azure DevOps Starter, and also GitHub Actions. Now, if you want to build, so compile source code, then you can use Azure DevOps, also Visual Studio App Center, then for mobile applications, and also GitHub Actions. It does kind of the same there. If you want to test your applications as well, so for instance, run unit tests or other types of tests within your build process or maybe within your release process, then also you could use these same services for that. They do that as well. If you want to deploy your application, well, guess what? All of these services can do that as well. So they are all build and also deployment services, and they can also test your application. If you want to create and build, create, build, and release pipelines, so not actually run them or have them, but just create them, then you would use all of these services, including the DevOps Starter, which we just saw, that is meant to create those pipelines within Azure DevOps. And then if you want to store and share source code, like in GitHub, for instance, then you could use GitHub Actions, as that is tied to GitHub, basically, so that works. But also Azure DevOps has a service for that, which is actually called Azure Repos, which you can use as a Git repository to store your code in. If you want to manage a work backlog, so items that your team needs to work on, then you could use Azure DevOps, which has a great solution for that. And also GitHub Actions again, because GitHub also has GitHub issues and now more advanced features as well that can help you with that. And if you want to manage mobile application life cycles, then you would use Visual Studio App Center because it's specialized in that. And then with that, I hope that this helps you to choose between the options that you can use to deploy your application to Azure.
Once again, extremely clear and thoughtful way to do things. And I actually mix and match myself as well. I do have a number of different sites that are using Azure DevOps. I found that Visual Pipeline to be really easy, and then I ended up converting that into YAML. Yeah. And then, you know, for smaller things, I'll use GitHub Actions. You lay that out in a very, very clean and organized way there. And folks can check you out online, on your blog, on your courses. Thank you so much for explaining deployment today on Azure Friday.
Hey, thanks for watching this episode of Azure Friday. Now I need you to like it, comment on it, tell your friends, retweet it. Watch more Azure Friday.